we're back. This is Boomer Life on CIAL 650. Money.
And we're back. Welcome to the show. This is Boomer Life on CIAL 650. I'm Joanne Sutton, joined by Jim Doyle, Senior Financial Consultant with Investors Group. So on Boomer Life today, we are talking about your financial future. A well-thought-out plan for your financial future is an integral part of building the life that you want for yourself and for your family. Now, before the break, we were discussing how it seems that planning for longevity is not typically part of the planning process for most people. So, Jim, can you elaborate a little bit more on this?
Yeah, longevity is a wonderful thing for those clients with the means to enjoy it. When it comes to providing value to clients, advisors need to offer more than just investment expertise. With a growing number of people over 65 choosing to work longer or part-time, these clients need help maximizing the timing of their income from sources from places like Canada Pension Plan or their RSPs. However, for clients who are financially unprepared for a long lifespan, aging can be an endurance test.
Absolutely. Financial literacy continues to be a big concern for a lot of Canadians. Why do you think that is? And why is financial literacy the foundation for financial success?
We recently hosted a financial planning seminar and thought a glossary of financial terms would be a great takeaway. Imagine our mixed feelings when we found a simplified layman's guide to financial terms that turned out to be 156 pages long. Nobody's going to read that. Unfortunately, financial jargon makes it difficult to understand many money issues, robbing people of their confidence and casting doubt on the decisions they need to take to take control of their finances. Financial literacy is more than just knowing about savings and spending. It's about integrating money management skills with confidence to make responsible financial choices. Like any skill, it needs to be learned, honed, and put into practice.
Are there any actual statistics out there to support this?
Well, yeah. There was a recent survey on financial literacy conducted by the Credit Counseling Society, and one of the highlights of the study noted 82% of Canadians with annual household incomes over $100,000 claim to be financially or highly financially literate, yet 42% of them don't follow a budget or spending plan. The disconnect between perceived financial literacy and the personal financial practices of Canadians is a clear indication that more needs to be done to bridge the financial literacy gap.
I actually like that statistic because it was the 82% of Canadians with the household income more than 100,000 that thought to be educated. And just because they had a financial income of over 100,000 doesn't mean that they're educated.
In my practice, I'm about helping one client at a time understand their investments, the risks that they're taking on, and creating a sense of confidence and competence in their financial literacy. We help remove the sense of embarrassment clients sometimes have when they come to us and aren't comfortable with the fact that they don't know how to read their statements or lack an understanding of their investments. We have many clients come to us after the passing of a spouse or the dissolution of a marriage, and they have reams of statements and records that they don't understand and find difficult to interpret. Their confidence in their financial know-how just isn't there. And why would it be? For those who have lost a partner, particularly those who had deferred financial decisions or matters to their partner, the learning curve can be rather steep. When you've never been brought into the process, knowing where to start can be a real challenge.
So what I hear you saying is don't beat ourselves up because we don't understand all the financial jargon.
Find a great advisor who's going to help. Absolutely.
Sure. So I have read studies that show clients of financial advisors tend to start saving earlier and they have a higher net worth. So Jim, if that is a proven fact, why don't people act on this?
Well, people are well-intentioned, but they're busy. Their lives are pulled in multiple directions, feeling they have the luxury of time to deal with these things at some point in the future. The truth is, have you ever found extra time? This is where working with an advisor and having a written financial plan becomes apparent, helping to maintain focus, provide motivation, and help keep clients on track.
I know there's a little bit more to it than just time, but there's never been a better time than right now to get started. So let's talk about the key steps to building financial security. Where can we start?
It starts with a prudent, process-driven, interactive money discussion. Some of the key points to discuss might include, well, say even the first key step, is to research and select your advisor or financial planner well. Creating great financial habits can be a little bit uncomfortable when change is involved, and be honest with your advisor about your knowledge, experiences, and expectations. You're going to need to trust that they understand you. This is the person that's going to help build your financial plan. Now, to build a financial plan, you're going to need to gather your financial data and records, incomes and expenses, and determine your goals and expectations, and to clarify your current financial status and identify any problem areas as well as opportunities. The next is to understand what your investments are and what risks or benefits they carry. Like, are they liquid? You know, can you get your hands on them when you need them? Or do your investments have the ability to generate income? Stay disciplined and keep you focused. Don't let market turmoil sway your planning decisions. And finally, regularly monitor, review, and reassess your financial plan.
So when seeking professional financial planning advice, expectations can often vary. Jim, what are some of the misconceptions that people have when it comes to financial planning?
Yeah, well, there's a few of them. I think one of the key ones is that folks sometimes confuse financial planning with investing. They neglect to set measurable financial goals. Perhaps neglect to evaluate their financial plan periodically. They think that financial planning is the same as retirement planning. Or expect unrealistic returns on their investments. It's possible they don't understand how their advisors are compensated. And here's a big one. Might be looking for a quick financial fix instead of a long-term strategy. Perhaps they don't understand that good professional planning advice is largely dependent on good information from clients. Perhaps they believe that financial planning is primarily tax planning, or that they'll lose control over their decisions if they use a planner. Remember that all of your financial decisions are interrelated, and the bottom line is achieving your financial goals.
I didn't see anywhere in your list about buying a lottery ticket and planning on winning the lottery.
Thank you.
It could be on a lot of people's lists, so. Okay, Jim, I'm just trying to be a little funny. Jim, let's say that someone wants to improve their financial situation. What would you suggest are some of the very key steps for interviewing and possibly engaging an advisor?
I think the first place to start is to find out if you only need help with investment selection and transactions, or if you're looking for a comprehensive financial planning advice that touches all aspects of your financial life. Let's assume you've asked friends or families for referrals, and you've got some recommendations from people whose financial needs, outlook, or stage of life is similar to yours. A couple of great questions to ask that advisor is, how do you get paid? What licenses or credentials do you have? What services do you or your firm provide? And what type of clients do you like to work with? And of course, what is your investment approach?
Wow, it's all about the client experience. What other questions could you ask of an advisor to get to know more about how they practice and the client experience that they offer?
Well, a big one that we often hear is, how much contact do you have with your clients? And what does that look like? Will I be working only with you or with a team? And what can I expect if I choose to work with you?
Mm-hmm. What are the expectations? That's a biggie. So, Jim, is there anything else different that you do in your practice?
Well, I guess it's one of the tough discussions that I have to have is whether it's going to be a mutual fit. Can I meet the client's expectations? Sometimes I have to say that the fit is not right, but I'm happy to make a referral to an appropriate professional to ensure that their needs are met. It makes little sense for me to initiate a client relationship knowing from the onset that I'm not going to be able to deliver on their expectations. It's a point of integrity to note that not every person is going to be or fit our ideal client.
Sure. I can say from my own personal experience that any financial discussion and just the thought of putting together a financial plan is completely overwhelming. I've tried to do it. I've put it off. I fall into that high percentage of the norm. Please tell our listeners about your approach.
I think the first place to start is to acknowledge, you know, you're not alone. People want actionable advice from a trusted source. Generally, we take a conservative approach to help you live comfortably today and protect your legacy for tomorrow. If the client is happy or is comfortable, we're happy to help work with their tax and legal advisors to provide a more comprehensive experience. We support financially comfortable families with an understanding that family dynamics are complicated and are often implicated when conflicts arise due to money matters. We take a tactful approach to sensitive matters. You know, 10 years ago, people wanted information. Today, they want help sorting through the information. That's where we come in, offering integrity, expertise, and an understanding of client needs. Now, we invest considerable time getting to know our clients, their history, their goals, and concerns, whether they take or want investment advice, or whether they're of the do-it-yourself variety. Remember, I work in the advice market, so it makes little sense for me to take on someone who really doesn't want or doesn't take advice.
I'm not sure about 10 years ago, people wanting the information, and today, them just wanting to sort through or help sorting through the information. I'm going to throw something at you here. What would you do if a client came to you and said, it's all too overwhelming. I don't really want or need or don't have the time to learn it all. It's too complicated. Can I just hand it all over to you, put it in your lap, and then let you look after it?
Well, that's a great deal of trust. Truth be told, we hear a lot more of this than you might think, and we must be careful on how we choose to proceed. We can help educate clients to make great decisions and help to instruct them to instruct us, but unfortunately, we can't make all the decisions for them.
Why is that?
While I'm generally not in favor of something called discretionary trading authority, that's where the broker makes all the investment decisions. For sophisticated investors, this can work, provided they understand all the risks involved. For those who do not have a good understanding of the risks involved, this is one of those matters you shouldn't delegate. Unintended losses and undesired tax consequences, depletion of capital, or interruptions to your income stream could be outcomes you might not want. If they insist, we're probably best to walk away. For most clients, if we take the time to make the process a whole lot less daunting, these clients often turn out to be some of the most loyal, long-term clients we have. Sometimes people just want to be heard. By taking the time to listen and explain investment risk in terms which are easily understood, by clearly explaining alternatives, and providing them with the time to make their decisions, we believe they're in a much better position to help us help them.
I respect your honesty and your integrity in that situation. It's not an easy one, is it?
It takes time.
A lot of time. You've been listening to Boomer Life on CL650. I'm Joanne Sutton. Today, we've been speaking with Jim Doyle, Senior Financial Consultant with Investors Group. We've been talking about understanding and avoiding financial missteps that a lot of people make for a lot of the wrong reasons, or all the wrong reasons. For more information and to get to know Jim a little bit better, simply go to jimdoyle.ca. Or you can call him toll-free, 1-800-665-7178, or call him at 604-682-5431. There's still a lot more to talk about with Jim Doyle, including thoughts on longevity and why enhancing or improving financial literacy is the key to financial success. That's coming up next on Boomer Life on CL650.
Celebrating the baby boomer lifestyle. This is Boomer Life on CL650.